So, Gavin, let's talk about your cinematography, your background. How did you get here? And then we'll get into the production.
Well, I went straight from school. Literally the day I left school, I knocked on the door of a film company, small film company in England, showed them my portfolio of stills. I said, you know, have you got a job, a holiday job, till I go to university? They said, yeah, we can give you a job for 9 weeks. We can't pay you anything. We'll pay your bus fare and lunch. I said, brilliant. Anyway, so I started working there. Loved it so much. Skipped university. Stayed there 4 years. Then worked for the BBC for 4 years. And then went freelance about, I don't know, 25 years ago. Right. So I've been freelance ever since. So starting off on film and worked my way through the various video cameras right. through to these current amazing cameras.
Okay, great. So, all right, let's dive straight into the production. Monkey Kingdom shot... Well, I'll let you talk about it, but it was shot in Sri Lanka on F-65s and some F-55s.
Yeah.
Set us up about the production. Give us some background. How did it come about? And then your involvement. And then let's get into the particulars of the cameras.
Well, I first worked in Sri Lanka about 19 years ago with Mark Linfield, who's the producer and director of this of Monkey Kingdom. And back then, we made what we thought was an amazing film, but we always knew there was more potential. And over the years, we talked about the possibilities of going back and doing it bigger and better. And finally, Mark put together a proposal, proposed it to Disneynature. They accepted it and very kindly asked me if I'd come along and shoot it. And that's where it all started. So we went back. I say it's been in production for about 3 years. I spent 2.5 years in the field on and off. And finally, as you say, on Friday the 17th, it hits the screens in the USA.
All right. So... What's the story? What was the motivation to do it?
Monkey society is really interesting. It's, you know, most animals, when you look at it, you just see animals wandering around. But the interesting thing about monkeys, they are very human-like in many respects. You don't have to be a scientist if you're watching a monkey to sort of read what it's thinking and what it's doing. You know, you can read in their eyes whether they're looking mischievous or looking angry. They're very expressive. And also with monkey society, you actually have a hierarchy. So you know, like have the king and the queen and you have all the servants below. So there's a very strict hierarchy. And that's what makes it interesting is that obviously the low-ranking animals are struggling more than the high-ranking ones who just can walk in and take whatever they want. So if you're a low-ranking female, as Maya is in the story, and she's struggling to bring up an offspring, she has to use her wits and intelligence and politics to be able to survive and actually make her life good and also make, you know, good for her son, Kip.
All right, great. So with that, we're going to roll the first clip of Monkey Kingdom. Disney was very kind enough to give us some scenes from the film, and we're going to start off with this very colorful trailer, and then we'll show some more clips after we talk about it.
Here we come. Walk down the street. We get the funniest looks from everyone we meet. Hey, hey, we're the monkeys. The people say we monkey around. Restless, there's always something new. Hey, hey, we're the monkeys. The people say we monkey around, but we're too busy singing to put anybody down. We're just trying to be friendly. Come and watch, sing and play. We're the young generation, and we've got something to say.
All right, that's really fantastic. Very humorous.
Thank you.
All right, so let's get into the particulars of the production. F-65s.
Yep.
Three of them. F-55s. Let's start with the 65. First of all, how did you select the 65 for the documentary?
Basically, Mark Linfield is very experienced. He's very techie. He understands. He's unusual for a director to understand. He probably knows a lot more about cameras than I do, to be honest. But he keeps his eye on the market and what cameras are out there and what they can produce and so on. And he said to me, there's a new camera out called the F-65. They're shooting a couple of big features on it. I think Oblivion was being shot at the time. He said, it looks like it's the best camera on the market. He said, the only downside is it's quite heavy because obviously what we're doing is not conventional filmmaking. We're, you know, traipsing around jungles having to carry these things. And he said, but that is the best camera out there without doubt. Anyway, I went up to the equivalent of NAB in London, the NEC. And I had a look, I saw this F-65 on the tripod, and it was all pimped up with monitors and follow focus and all the stuff that makes it look like on a feature film. And I said, do you mind if I pick it up? And they said, no. Anyway, I just picked it up and put it on my shoulder. And it was heavy, but I thought, that's not unmanageable, even at my age. And so next time I saw Mark, I said, no, I think if that's the best camera, that's what we should go on. You know, it's going to take us 3 years to make the film. So in 3 years' time, there may well be a better camera out, which I don't think there is, actually. Right. So I think we should go for it. And so we decided on the F-65. The first thing we did, we were able to actually slim it down. Believe it or not, we shaved 3.8 kilos off the camera just because I was going to have to carry it.
Right.
So we were able to take off all the extra bits we didn't necessarily need for this production.
Right.
And it was definitely the right choice to choose that camera. I think the pictures are amazing.
Yeah, they're incredible pictures. Now, let's talk a little bit about the settings of the camera you used in the environment. Obviously, the green channel of the 65, because of the double bayer, gives you amazing eye-popping green color with full 4K resolution. But you shot it in RAW, 16-bit RAW, on the cards, right?
And yeah, we started on RAW light because we were worried about the data, you know, over 2.5 year production. We thought we were actually going to hit the petabyte level, which would have been massive storage. But actually, when we realized that we weren't shooting that much, we were being quite controlled with the shooting, we went to, you know, full-on RAW.
Right.
You know, so we'd have the most we could get out of it when it came to post-production.
Right.
Again, with RAW, obviously, you don't have to worry about color balance or anything like that, only for monitoring. And the camera does it all. I mean, for me, what was interesting, I grew up shooting on film, and there's not much you can do. You can put filters in front depending on what film stock.
Right.
But with this camera, it was very much like shooting film for me. You just, as long as you got the exposure right, you had a lot of latitude. Mm-hmm. It's a very forgiving camera. And, you know, having shot HD for years, to go onto a camera like this, suddenly it makes my camera work look very good again, hopefully.
Right. And so tell us about some of the shooting conditions that you were having to deal with. Very hot, very humid.
Yeah, I mean, particularly for Monkey Kingdom, it was the heat and the humidity. And as with all these digital cameras, they do get quite hot, and that's always a worry. Certain cameras don't handle the heat well, and you've got fans blasting in your ear.
Right.
And amazingly, it didn't seem to be an issue for the F-65 at all, neither the F-55. The year before, I'd worked on a previous Disneynature film, Bears, which came out last year, and there I was using up in Alaska, where you've got obviously extreme cold temperatures.
Right.
And likewise, it handled that very well.
Yeah, we're just looking at the temperature, the hurricane.
All right, that was a hurricane that passed. We were just up to the left of the eye of the hurricane.
Right.
And I think we got some pictures of the camera in a plastic bag
being
looked after.
Yes, yes.
So the camera actually seems remarkably rugged. We didn't, obviously, you get the occasional.
Where is this?
That was a cold day. That was. That's on the beach. That was the landing strip in Alaska. That's when the plane came to actually take me out of there at the end of the production.
Oh, okay.
But just to show the conditions that I've seen that camera being, you know, I've used that camera in, and
right.
it seems to,
right.
you know, it doesn't get treated as well as it would be, say, in a Hollywood studio.
Yeah, of course, right.
You know, it's out there. It's a working tool.
Right. So we're looking at some rigs here. Walk us through what we're seeing here.
One of the things I wanted to do, you know, my influence on the look of the overall movie was to be able to get movement into the shots. You know, we're so used to seeing camera movement in so many things we see on television now.
Yeah.
You know, even on Breakfast News, they've got moving cameras. And as we all know, what it does is it separates layers and it gives depth to the picture rather than just using shallow depth of field, which obviously we've done as well.
Right.
Again, conventionally, you know, Hollywood gear that we're seeing here at NAB is quite heavy. It's designed for two or three people. You have separate grips to carry stuff.
And locked off on a tripod most of the time.
And locked off on a tripod. And what I've done is I've personally developed some of these lighter rigs to be able to get the same Hollywood moves, but you know, two or three people can carry all the kit in. This is a motion control rig set up on lightweight tracks. This was a scene in the station, again, you know, just trying to get some movement in, leading the audience on this journey with the monkeys. And as you can see, putting it to the test, the camera, putting it in a few risky situations. That's occasionally when it was really hot, we would put an umbrella. I mean, just as you would, you'd shade yourself.
Right.
So we'd give the camera a helping hand and keep it in the shade and so
right.
on.
Right.
Yeah.
So you shot S-Log 3.
When we started the production, S-Log 3 wasn't
That's
out.
Right.
So we shot on S-Log 2
right.
and stayed on S-Log 2 for
you
the
on S-Log
duration.
2. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. And you use a monitoring LUT in
Yeah, so monitoring 709 LUT in the viewfinder. Okay. Again, without that, it's...
Right.
You know, don't forget, what we're doing is we don't have focus pullers.
Right.
we don't have rehearsals with the monkeys we're working with. They, you know, they do whatever they want to do, so you're trying to predict what they're doing. Mm-hmm. So every time you pull focus with an animal walking towards you, you don't get a second chance. So basically, you get very good at keeping things in focus.
So let's talk about focus here, because that's always people are asking how you guys are doing this with subjects like monkeys that will not stop for a second. And you're shooting with a very high resolution camera. Focus is absolutely critical. Tell us about some of the focus tools you used in the camera to achieve what you did.
Shooting for the big screen, as we know, is hyper critical. TV, you can get away with a certain amount, but you pump, you know, you blow it up to a big screen and it's not very forgiving. Right. When we started the production, I'd never worked on a large sensor camera before. I'd done some 35mm stuff, but not, you know, as much as this. It reminds you that the focus is hypercritical. And in fact, a lot of the rushes, when we were reviewing them at the end of the day, we were actually having to throw away about sort of 60% because it was soft.
I'm 60%?
Yeah.
Every day?
Yeah.
Wow. Okay.
So, as I say, there's no rehearsals each time you pull focus. Right. Anyway, obviously we got better and better because there's some stuff that's in focus. But one of the useful tools on the F65, and actually this evolved over the time of the production, was the 2x4x function. So you can assign that to one of the buttons. And what's great is it's, you know, pixel for pixel, it actually will punch in. So if you're focusing it up, sometimes you'd focus something, you'd hit record, you think, oh, better just check it's in focus.
Right.
You tab zoom in, it was just slightly off, but, you know, zooming in like that, you could actually get the focus spot on. Mm. And the nice thing was, is as the firmware evolved, you could actually do that, you could do that while you're recording. Mm. So sometimes you've got a locked off shot, you can, and we actually rigged the camera so you could have the tab zoom on your thumb on the pan handle. So you don't have to take your hand off the lens.
Right, so that was one of the photos there where you had the drill through the, and then you cabled it out to the handle. That was for the zoom?
Yeah, we got a tech guy at Top Techs in London, UK to drill a hole, and he put two wires onto that assign number one,
right.
And that's what we had for the zoom. So yeah, literally we had stop start, so record stop on one thumb, and then another button, and all I did is put a little bit of Velcro on,
right,
so you knew which one.
Which.
Yeah.
So it doesn't sound like a big deal, but you were telling me offline earlier that was super critical for this project, the ability to be able to do a 2x4x punch in.
And we're not working off, you know, on a standard Hollywood set. You might have a 17-inch monitor, and you can really, your focus puller can see on a big screen really critically. But we're not. We're operating off the viewfinder.
Right.
And also, when we started off, the viewfinder was the LCD,
right,
which was great to be able to work in color.
Right.
But when they introduced the OLED,
right,
suddenly it got a lot easier. And also, I think you'll see it. Obviously, we got better at pulling focus, but I think the OLED helped. So actually, in the end, we're probably only getting maybe 10% out of focus.
Okay.
You know, if you're being hypercritical.
The OLED viewfinder, you found it to be very good?
Yeah, for me, of all the viewfinders I've used, it works very well for my eye. I think it's amazing.
And you used 55s as well. We saw a couple of pictures here where the 55s were rigged up. Can you talk to us about those cameras?
Yeah, so we had the 55 for the more awkward situations where you couldn't get the physical size of the 65 in, or you wanted to shoot two cameras on an event you thought was going to, you know, pay off for the film.
Right.
The 55 would quite often be put remote. In fact, there it is on the prototype M15 Movi.
Right, right.
Again, you wouldn't get the 65 on a Movi yet.
Right.
We used it for remote stuff, for the tracking. We used it for a few crane shots.
Okay.
But actually, I think the picture intercut incredibly well.
Right.
And I suppose the only reason you'd go to a 65 is you want the higher resolution.
Well, you got the 8K sensor. You got the green, which pops significantly, and the other features that you were talking about. So.
Yeah, going back to the double green channel, I think for what we were doing, considering most of the time we're in the wild, bulk of your frame is always green. So having that extra color depth in the greens, I think, is what really makes these pictures sing on the screen.
Yeah, incredible. All right, so Terry, if you can cue up the second Monkey Kingdom clip. Tell me about the... sorry, Terry, before we roll that, tell me about the wireless.
iPad app.
Yeah,
yeah. Yeah. Again, this is something that was evolved over the production, and it just got better and better, but the iPad app meant that that was Martin Kolbeck, the other director of photography with Luke. And with the iPad app, it meant that our assistants were able to really help. You know, you might be filming something and you think, right, I need to go to 50 frames.
Right.
And before, you take your eye away, you select 50 frames, dial it in, select it, thing would come up to speed. Right. What you could do is I could be filming, I could say to Robbie, my assistant, I'd say, Robbie, go into 50 frames, take one ND out, and literally he'd line it up on the iPad. As soon as I cut, he could see I'd cut, he'd hit the button, and those things would be written instantly to the 65. Yeah. It would come up to speed, and I could record. Yeah. And probably shaving 4 or 5 seconds off me actually taking my eye away from the camera and having to do it on the side of the camera. And that's for what we're doing. You know, you might wait all day for a shot.
Right.
You don't want to miss it just because you're fiddling around with a menu.
Right, right.
So some very key features made a huge difference in this type of production that I think other cameras, they can't do, right? They don't have these features.
And originally we were starting off to be able, for the assistants to be able to monitor and the director to be able to monitor, we were using a Teradek link. But actually when they came out with the Wi-Fi picture link, right. again, that was handy because Robbie was already carrying about 30 kilos, 66 pounds of stuff. Right. Right. He didn't want to then have to carry a monitor and a battery and the Teradek. Right. So he could do it all from the iPad and see the picture. Right. So he knew what I was on.
Yeah, so it's interesting because as your skills in the focusing and shooting this very unique environment developed during the course of the production, the F-65 was also developing during the course of production. Then you were adapting to that as time went on and taking advantage of those features as they were developed in the firmware.
Yeah, I mean, those tools just made the job easier and easier. Mm. And what was great is we were giving feedback to Sony
right.
and asking for these particular things, and they were being implemented, you know, pretty quickly. So, I mean, just talking the last few evenings with your right. guys and just saying what would be great on the next camera
right.
or updating these.
Right.
And they're taking notes and they're listening, and it's great to think you actually have an influence on how these cameras will be made.
Right. Okay. Let's roll the second clip because we're getting tight on time.
Welcome to the world, Kip. Maya is consumed by unconditional love. She is lost in her infant.
That's absolutely beautiful footage.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Well, as you can see, one thing we tried to utilize, myself and Martin, was the shallow depth of the ability to have a shallow depth of field. Right. And you can really draw the audience's eye into exactly what you want them to look at, right. but without losing a sense of place. So Maya with her son Kip there, you can still see a monkey in the background. There's right. a sort of right. lovely softness about it, but you're just drawn and compelled to look at right. the thing, you know, we want you to look at.
Right.
All right, so if we can roll the last clip, because we are getting a little tight, and then we'll come back and hit a few closing questions.
When the troop finally enters the urban jungle, they are ravenous. Using her instincts, Maya leads them to the market. Kumar makes the first move. Makes it look easy.
Yeah.
His students watch and learn. Maya is in the thick of the action, while Kip stays safe above.
Well, so this particular scene was a multi-camera shoot.
Yeah, so during the dry season, the food is scarce in the forest, which is when the monkeys are most likely to be raiding, you know, going into the town and taking their opportunity. So for that, these scenes, it made sense for that short time
right.
to have three cameras on it because, you know, one camera, you don't know where the monkeys are going to go.
Right.
I'd say nothing's predictable. Right. And the other thing is often what happened is you'd set up a camera and the monkeys are very nervous to go and steal food. And they'd see you there and they think that, you know, you're waiting to throw a stone and chase them off.
Right.
But if you had two or three positions with the cameras, there was more chance of being able to get it. That's the scene is slightly longer in the film, but it took about 3 weeks to film that.
Really? Three weeks?
Yeah, it makes it look like they're stealing stuff all the time, but I can assure you, you might spend all day and get one shot.
Wow.
and then it's out of focus or, you know, frame wrong or something. Wow. So, yeah, so it just made sense to cover certain things with three cameras.
All right, let's take some questions either from the audience here or from online. We'll get online as well. Any questions from the audience?
Yep.
Did you ever take advantage of using the iPad for being able to be away from the camera?
Yeah, we did. The question was, did we ever take advantage of using the iPad to be away from the camera? Yeah, again, the iPad connectivity was brilliant. I mean, it would work. I mean, out there, there's no wireless interference, so it would work up to maybe 20, 25 meters. So, yeah, you could use it as a remote stop-start. So sometimes, even with a 65, you might set it up on a wide angle, and you could come back. Or it might be, I'm in a really awkward position with the camera, and I don't want to take my hand off to be able to push the record button, so I could ask Robbie just to hit record and stop. Yes, I mean, it's a useful feature.
Any other questions? Sorry, we're going to have Alison Mandera backstage here. Alison, do you have a question from social media? So, learning the behaviours of the monkeys and getting to know their personalities, how did that impact the filmmaking process?
So I'm not a scientist, but I've spent most of my life filming wildlife, and you just get to read it. The same as we all do with people, you can tell if somebody's looking aggressive or if they're looking relaxed. Likewise with the monkeys, you can tell if a monkey's looking towards somewhere, you think, well, they're just about to go, the same as if somebody was looking towards the door. So you just apply it. The good thing with monkeys, you can apply a lot of the same skills, you know, if you're judging humans, as you can with them. So again, you can, and they've got forward-facing eyes, they make it very clear what their intentions are. But obviously, the more time you spend, the easier it becomes.
Mm-hmm. All right. Conclusions, wrap up. Your experiences obviously were incredible.
Conclusions. I know I'm sat on a Sony stand, but actually, what I like about these two cameras is they make me look good again. So, well, hopefully they do. Maybe that's up to them to judge. But I think the pictures on the big screen, I saw the premiere screening on Sunday, and I just think that the pictures look amazing. And I think it's probably the first time I've seen lots of generations of video cameras and codecs and recording media and so on. And I think this is the first time where the cameras actually have superseded what film can do, in my opinion.
Okay. Gavin Thurston, ladies and gentlemen. Gavin, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Fantastic. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right.